back to Bug Array, and here we are on the last section whereby we'll be doing the integration of the website with the API. So yeah, thanks for getting to this section. I hope you watched the prior videos and that helped a lot. So now let's now do the integration. So what we'll need is firstly, I recommend that we first create our models, right? Because we're going to need those models to probably send data, right? So what I will do is create, create a file called models, right? In this file called models, then I'll stop this, right? ng generated class. This will be user, that will be the user, right? ng generate class, this is the user, right? That should work. I made a mistake. Let me just delete this for now. And cd dash dash and cd, this is user forward. Now this is models, right? Forward slash. So ng generate class, and then this is the user class, right? Okay, now we're generating that. And then we'll ng class, and then we'll generate the party class, that single party class, right? And then I guess the next one is user vote class, right? So ng generate class, it's user vote, user underscore vote. I guess we're done creating our models. So what we'll need to do is now go to the TS file. I want to start at the user. So go to the TS file. We'll need a user ID, right? We'll need a user ID, which is of type number, right? We'll use a username, which is type string, right? We'll need a password. So password, which is of type string. Okay. Now that's sorted out for that. And let's now go to our party, right? We set the party. We need the party ID, which is of type number. We'll need the name, right? Which is just a string. We'll need the image, if I'm mistaken. Image, which is of type string, right? And the vote count comes here, right? Count, which is just a number. So the vote count comes there, which is just a number. So the next thing we'll want to have is the votes, right? User vote. So with user vote, what we'll have there is the vote. It's the vote ID, which is just a number, right? And then next up, we'll have the vote. Let me check that. Okay, that's still working. So we'll have the vote ID, user ID, right? Which is just a number. And then we'll have a... That's party ID. Which is just a number. This is just a number, and then we'll save that. Guess we're done with our models. So what we'll want to do after that is have a service, right, which is going to do the integration. But first of all, we'd like to first create our HTTP error interceptor, which is gonna handle our errors when we do like the communication with the API. So in that instance, we'll need a folder right here, which is a helper folder. So we'll have a helper folder, right? In this helper folder, so we'll need to say cd backslash, then cd helper, yes, yeah, now ng generate interceptor, right, and then error. We want to make our interceptor, yeah, our interceptor is an error. It's an error interceptor. So now that's created for us, right? So in this class, right here, we'll need to have an import catch error. So we'll import this from this guy dot operations, if not mistaken. Operators, is it operators? I guess, yeah. So we'll have that, right? And then we'll need to pipe that, and we'll have this method called tap. We'll need the tap, right? So we'll say a tap is, we'll get the data, do an error function, and just console what we're getting there, right? So we'll console the data that we're getting. And after that, we wanna then now catch the error, if there is an error, right? So in that instance, we'll need to say error, do an error function. Do an error function, close that off, and just return throw error, which is just an error. So that's tap, bam. All right. So what did I possibly do wrong? Right? I can most then remove this, right? For now, have that quick tap. Nah, that's not gonna solve my issue. Right? That's till there, comma, catch error. Let's see that. If I've got that. Nah, that's not gonna help us with anything. So what we'll need is to still have that import, right? So let's just do this. Import from those tabs, errors. Oh, then we'll need to change that to any, right? Change that as well to any. So that will be any. Return a throw error. We wanna throw an error, which is error. Okay. All right. So I managed to do the fixing on that. So I needed to do an import, right? Where I catch the error, the tab, and then what you need to then do is just pipe that, put that in that tab, have the data, do the error function, console log that, and that's it. Alright, so we have created our error interceptor. So what we'll need to do right now is to have an import. We'll need to import some stuff, which is the catch error. Catch error and the tap, right? Which is from rxjs. Slash operators, right? And then that's just, yeah, what we need there. So we'll gin pipe this, And then have this function tap, pass in the data in there, do an arrow function for that, have a comment there that catching the error, because in this instance after that we want to just catch an error. So we'll have an error that we want to catch, arrow function, and then we'll want to console.log our error, just return throw error. We want to return the error, right? And then here we'll want to just console log the data we're getting, right? So yeah, that's just it for our error interceptor. But now, since we're done doing like the error interceptor, we'll then need to provide that, right, in our app modules. So what we need there, we'll need this object here, and we need to provide HTTP interceptor, HTTP interceptors. And then we'll have this use class, this error interceptor that we have. And then we'll have this multi is true. So that's just it for that. And then after that's done, we also noticed that we'll need to also create some services where we're going to be which we're going to be using to call those endpoints. So in that instance, we'll need a file in app, right? The file will be called services, right? These are our services. And then in services, cd --, and then we'll want cd services, right? We'll ng generate a service called, what service do we want to call this? I think we should call our services our components. So we'll say it's a user service, right? So that's done, right? So in our user service, we'll have a register and a login. So in that instance, we'll want to make that public. We'll want to say public login, right? And then that's a method on its own, and then we'll have a public register, right? That's another method. So, but first thing, because we'll be making a request to an external endpoint, we'll need to do that using this HTTP client. So we'll say private HTTP using this HTTP client, right? So we'll be using this HTTP client. We'd also want to put in, like, in our environments variable, we would want to have some sort of variable which will be called our base URL. So we'll have our base URL. So this is just the URL in which we're going to be doing those endpoints from. So how can I get that? Let's just open my Postman. Let me save this for now. Save that as well. White base URL. Let me close this, because this is probably that local host, whatnot, right? So it's like HTTP local host. It's just that I don't want to get it all wrong. So let's wait for that to open so we can then get our URL. So we'll get this until there, right? Copy that, go into our base URL, and then we'll paste that there, right? So this is the URL on which we're gonna be making calls to, right? Okay, that's sorted out. So we know this is going to be a post request and it will return something. So we'll return an any, right? And here we'll want to have an any, right? So we want to return this HTTP, right? Dot post method, right? And then we'd want to have that from our environments variable. So that will be that environments, right? I guess from our environment.base URL, right? And then forward slash, we'd want to say this is user forward slash login, right? That's just our endpoint. And then we're going to get this user, which we're going to be passing into this method, right? To the body, right? So that's done. And this is just the same thing for the login as well. So for the register, I meant to say, we'll need to have a user, right? Any, right? Just that we'll need to change that to register. I guess that's done. But we need to import this HTTP client module in our app module, because this wouldn't work. So HTTP client module. So that's imported. Okay, imported. We have that in our import. And then what would we want to do now is just test if the login works. We want to serve that, right? We'd want to run our API. Oh, but one thing to also note is during our creation of our API, we didn't enable our cause. So you might get like an issue whereby it's telling you that you cannot access it because of blocked calls. So in order to resolve that issue, you just need this two lines of code where you just enable your calls attribute and just have these stars, right? So the one is for the origin, the other one is for the headers, and yeah, that also third parameter. And then you'll just pass that in your config, right? And that's just it. So okay, this is running, meaning it's a good sign. Now let's go to our login and just test if we can log in. So we go to pages, login, there we go. So we'll have to have like this user service. So we'll have private user service equals to our user service, right? So we'll use this dot user service dot login, because we wanna log in, right? And then we'll pass in just a temporary temporary object, right? Just a static object with our username and password. We know that this are credentials that are there. So let's test if that works. So we'll pass in our user, then want to get that promise, wanted to return it as a promise, right? As a promise. Then we want to have this data type any, right? Error function. And then we just want to console.log our data that we're getting from this endpoint. So dot catch, want to catch an error. So when we're catching an error, we can have that. You don't have to like name it that, but yeah, you could use that as well. This is of any, right? And then this will say console.log your error, your error. So where did I go wrong now? Huh. That's fine. Now where did I go wrong? Let's see. Was it there? Okay, there's something I removed, which I guess I shouldn't have removed. I think I have to close that once or close it again. Now what's up? Nah, start all over. We have that right there. Then we wanna catch an error. Type any right error function. Right, we wanna just console.log our error. Because we called it error. So yeah, let's see if this works. So when we click our login, it should send us to our homepage. Let's see what we're getting. So did we start our server? I think that's started. I meant to say service. Okay, let's see if that works. Now we're gonna open here our console. Alright, so did we ng-serve? Yeah. Then let's see, we're getting an object back. Yeah. So meaning that we are logged in. So if I were to change this to something else, then it should give us like an error. This should give us an error, like this is a bad request. We can't do that. So let's now go back to this this application of ours. For now, let's just leave that at that. But now we wanna add like reactive forms, right? So we can reactive forms, right? To just check our user inputs and yeah. Let's see. Nah, I don't think we'll need that. Nah, I don't think we'll need such. Do we? Nah, we don't need that. That's just trying to be fancy. All we need is having a variable out here, which is gonna be check login. Check login. So which will be true. No, which will be false, right? Initially. So this will say if this guy is this check login, right? Check login equals to true, then this should state that you have an error. I have to say this dot. So what will happen is here in our login, we will want to create some sort of a p tag with the class of error text. So this error text, what will happen there is it will then return to us like an error message. So we'll want to put that in our global styles and just have that like that. The color will be red just to display our errors. So what will happen is if we'll have an ng if, right? If our check login is true. So if this is true, then just display that your username or password was incorrect, right? Username or password is incorrect. That's only if that is true. Okay, so what else do we need to do now? So that will be true, and then that will be what's this? Okay, let's just say check login will start off as false every time we do a login, and then if it's true, then obviously we need to render that. So let's go to our login. In this instance, we weren't supposed to even redirect at that instance. So we want to redirect only if we logged in successfully. Otherwise, just stay on that page. So username or password was incorrect. So that's nice for us. Nice thing to know. So what I would like to also do is just put that on like in the, so we wanna say the margin equals to auto. Its margin will be on the auto. Let's now go there and test that. Yeah, so username or password is incorrect. So you can't then log in, right? So what we'll want to do now is that get the username from now this and just pass it into our object. So how we'll go about doing that is going into our login and then saying that before we log in, right, we would want to get this username, right? This is this username, this dot username, and then this will be this dot password, this dot password. This is this dot password. Ah, what did I do? Right, this dot password, right? And then now we can just use that from our site. So Sibonelo 123, that should say username incorrect 143. This should send us to our home page, and we got that. So now we can successfully log in, but now we wanna also just try logging in a new user, right? So in that specific scenario, we want to check this user that's coming in, right? So on our last creation of this register, we didn't create like a confirmation password. I think we needed that, right? So we can have that as a password. Password, that's fine. I don't think we need this, right? Confirm password, right? This is just saying, okay, we want to confirm our password, then we'll say confirm here. We'll create this confirm here. Confirm. Right? Confirm password. Yeah. In this instance, would we need our reactive forms? But nah, I don't think we'll still need that. I think it's, we could still make this work without having to use reactive forms. So what we'll do in this instance, we'll just check, have an ng container over here. This ng container will check if ngf. So if, only if the username and password are equal, right? So this will check if the password is equal to confirm, right? Only if this and this are equal. Okay, so what I will do there is just create a button here, right? That will be that will be disabled, right? Because I don't want you to register if your username and password don't match. So basically basically here we would want to say that we would want to have this disabled when the username is not equal to the confirmed. So that should be disabled, right? Okay, so in our global CSS, we'd wanna just say if our button, right, is disabled, right, then our background color should be gray for that button. So let's just check in our application. Did we get to something? Or did this crash? Yeah. Now let's just see what happened there, right? We had that and that, right? So let's just go to our register. What happened to our register? All right, so we didn't do a save, right? So let's go to our register. Right, so now we have that, and we shouldn't be allowed to actually click that button if ever. Okay, let's just do this. Styles outline is none, and then our border is none. Yeah, I just don't want that outline and the border, right? If that's disabled. Is that the case? Let's make it green. What's up with that button? I want to see something. Why isn't it then? Why isn't it grayed out? Okay, let's go to our register. This is a button disabled if this if or no, the password equal to now, right? If the password is equal to now, is equal to that, or pass confirm, if the confirm is equal to that, right? So, then let's now see. Yeah, that's green. So now what we can now do is go back to this guy over here and just make it gray, right? Grayed out. Yeah, you can't click on that because now it's not allowed. So what will happen is then the user will say enter a name, right? 123 and 123, right? But if it's 123, then that means they can then log in because the passwords would have been like equal, meaning that they match. So what we'll want to do now is now call that register API, right? So we'll come here and have a click function to this button, right? So we'll click, right? And then in our click, we'll just say register handler. So we'll have this register handler, right? Copy that, put this in our method here, and then have that, right? Sort it out for us. And then here, we'll wanna have a private we want to have a private user service, right, for our user service, that's user service, right? And then this will be this dot user service dot register. Want to register that, and then we want to pass in our user data. Would have been easier if we used reactive forms now, I see, but anyway, we've already done what we done. So username equals to this dot username, right? This dot username, and then our password, oh, that's that, shouldn't be equal to, yes, our password equals to that, and then this should return to promise, right? And then I like to have it in just the next line. Then have our data, right? Error function, and just console.log our data for now. So for now, we just want to console log our data. And then here, we'd want to have this error. Right? We just want to console.log our error. All right. So now what will happen in this instance is when we push this register, it should then initially do like the register for us, right? So only if we get an output which is like an error, we'll just say failed to register, right? This username already exists, actually. We'll just say username already exists. So we could have a method, we could have like a boolean here, which is check register, right, which is equal to false, right? And then over here we can just have that equal to false again, right? This dot, and then here we'll say this dot check register equals to true, right? We don't want to do all the hard work, right? So we're just gonna come here, copy that, come here over here. We want to come over here and say play this guy. What's going on? We want to come over here and just display to the user that username already exists. Okay, this username already exists, so that's for check register, right? This username already exists. So in this instance, now we'd want to just log in with Sibonelo 123123, and then this should say username already exists because this user already exists, even if I can try something like that. Okay, so now let's say Bob. We've got this user called Bob, right? His password is just 123123. Let's see. So if this guy is trying to log in and then everything is successful, what this guy would want to do is just print. You know what I want to do? Let's just print out a user message, right? And then we'll start that off as a clear message. And then if we get our user here, we'll just say data. We'll say we'll get that data. Yeah, that we're getting from that object, right? Yeah, we'll get that from this data. You reckon? Yeah, I think that's okay. We'll get that there. And then this will just change this guy to username already exists. Right, yeah, this is a better approach, I think. So we don't need to have then that check over here, right? We can just remove this ngf here and just return our message. This dot now error message, was that the name? Oh yeah, I just said user message. Why did I call that? But it's still gonna work for us. So close this guy. So if I try to log in as Sibonelo, right, this will have to tell me, okay, this shouldn't log me in, right? 2 3 username already exist. But now if I have to say Bob, password is 123, you have successfully registered for voting. So we're done with that. What we'd like to do is store this in like some sort of after logging in, we would want to store the data we're getting back from the user to some sort of local storage, right? So what we'd want to do then in that instance is have local storage, right, which is now our, so this is just the user data we're going to get back, which is of type data, right? So that's that. Local storage dot set, we want to set this item to that. So we want the user to just get that data from the, because we will need to use the user ID in some instance, right? So Sibonelo 12143, and then when they log in, that data should be in our local storage. So it is in our local storage, I believe so, dot get item. So if we get our user data, right? Yeah, there is this object in there, right? So that is sorted now, right? So what we want to do is now go to our home page. So since we're getting to our home page, we would want to then have like some sort of a service that's going to get our parties, right? So in that instance, we would want to come over here. Just stop that, and in our services, ng generate service, and this will be party service, right? Yeah, this is just a party service. Wait a bit. Okay, why is that taking quite some time? Okay, now we've created that service. First thing we want to do, surely now you see like some sort of a repetition, HTTP client, right? We'll have an HTTP client, and then we'll have a get public, get all parties, right? Which returns an any, right? Return HTTP dot get any, right? And then there we'll use this from this environment dot base URL. Wanna get that from the base URL, that's slash party, right? Party slash get. What did we call that? party controller that was called, did we even have a name for that one? Oh, we did, yeah. This was party slash get party. Get parties. And that's just it. So what we will do is that we will have that in our home page, right? So that when the user first, like when the user gets to the home page, in the init function, we then want this user to get all these parties that are then initially going to be rendered, right? So this party, so we'll need to just remove that. We don't need that anymore. So we'll need to say parties. We'll need to say party array, because this is just an array of our parties, right? And then that, and then this is an array of this is an array of this model party, right? Close that guy off. And what we will need to do is have that, right? Okay, this dot, we want that service first. We want to have that service. And then this will be our party service, which is party service. So this dot party service dot get all parties, right? And then what, we don't need to pass in anything there, just get that as a promise, right? But then, right, then we'll have this data, which is of any error function console.log our data. But now we're going to pass this data into this parties array, which is now going to equal to this data we're going to be getting, right? Then we would want to also catch that. We'd want to catch that and just say that, okay, that will be a type error. Any, close that in brackets, and then we'll just want to console.log our error, right? And then we'd want to close that guy, yeah. So we'd want to close that guy and then pass in this party in there. So, why did I change that? Actually, that doesn't make sense why I changed that. Okay, but party array, and then we'll have a name. Let's now go to that party component, which is the party card. So in there, we'll have that guy as the name. Let's see if the names, we do actually get the names. let's see if we are on our home page. We probably stopped. We should initially get all the parties, right? Wait for a couple of moments. Okay, this is just taking its own time now. Three years later, 4 years later, and we haven't got our data. What is going on? So what's happening now is we'd want to check what we're getting in our homepage. So yeah, we are actually getting our parties. So now we would just want to just change our Now we will just want to come here and change this image, right? And then this will be vote.image. Don't you think? This is supposed to be vote image. Let's just come here. Where are we now? Oh, my guy. This is party. This is vote image, right? Ah, we were supposed to do that. That's fine. That should get the images for us. Will it? Moment of truth. What is going on? I think there was an issue. Yeah, we got our images. So that's the thing. Okay, let me just set the height of the height to just a static height so that all our images are of the same height, right? So the height for the image will just be 100 pixels. I'll just make that 100 pixels so that all our images have the same height. So we see that we've got the ANC, we've got that. Let's see, we can even do the voting. All right, that works. All right, so we have all our parties rendered in our home page, but now we want to do like our actual voting, right? So we needed to change a bit on how we did the voting before. I'm sorry, man, this icon for the VS Code and Visual Studio are almost identical, so I tend to click on that. Right, so what I would want to do is, over here, I'll create this variable called vote ID, right? So now this vote ID will equal to -1, right? When it starts off, right? And then I'll then have some sort of an input here. Let me come here. Right. So I'd want to pass in like a vote ID into this party class. So how I'll go about doing that is I'll have this input, right? That's gonna allow me to pass in a specific number to the child component. So this input will be passed into this the party card, right? And then what will happen here, because since we have this event emitter, right, that's going to be giving us all the data of that party we're clicking at, right? So I would say this dot vote ID is now equal to this event dot party ID, because I'll be getting back the party ID. But what I would want to do is change this vote to party, right? And what did I do? Did I change it to the model party, right? Yeah. So I change this to party and have that because I'm just passing in a single party. Remove that. And then here on my actual HTML here, I'll say, where vote.party ID, right? If the vote.party ID equals to this vote ID that I'm getting in from the parent component, right? So let's test that out. Yeah, so now that's working. I can now do the votes. So what I will need to now do is do some integrations to allow the user to actually process like a specific vote. So how that will work is by me creating like a button just here at the top. So I'll just have this button or could have had button, right? That's the easiest way. Class will equal to button all. I know this way won't be that nice, but btn all, that's how I call it. Then process, let's check that in our UI. Why is that there? Ah, I forgot, that's a grid. So I will need to put this guy over here. No, what am I doing? I'll need to put this guy over here. So this will be a class button all. And let's see that on our UI. So this will be our process button after this user is done. So what will happen here, we'd want to disable it. We'd want to disable this button. This should be disabled while the vote underscore ID equals to -1. Right, when it's equal to -1, I just want to disable that button. Yeah, this is disabled, right? But the moment it's that, then the user can must then click the button, right? So what will then happen is when the user clicks the button, we want to call this method here. So the method is actually going to be called process vote. So I would want to process a specific vote, right? Yeah, I think that's a proper name. Have that there. And then what I will need to do is have like a service for the user vote, right? So I need to stop that, go to my services, or I'm at my services, ng generate service, user vote service. Yeah, I think this is user vote service. Let's see now what I get. Now let's go to our services. Where are our services? This is user vote. Yeah. This is our user vote service. What we want to have is a private, let's see, don't make that mistake, HTTP, which is an HTTP client, right? So the HTTP client will have a public user vote, right? Which will then initially return an any, right? This dot http dot post, I think we made it a post, right? Any, right? And then we'll have that from the environments dot base url slash is it user vote? Let's check that from our API. So it's voting, so that's votes, right? So that would be from the votes, right? And then what is it? Add vote. We want to add a vote, right? So they'll be adding a vote, and then the vote will be whatever they will be voting for, right? This will be a vote, and then that's type any. So we're going to pass that into that method, and now we'll need to go to our home page. So what would actually happen now is that on our home page is we would wanna come to this process, have this dot first the constructor, we need the service private, this private user vote service, right, equals to the user vote service, right? And then now this user vote service dot is it a user vote? Did I say user vote? Did I name it user vote? Let's find out. So this will then be from this const, we're gonna get constant vote, right? Where we'll need the user ID, right? So when it starts off, when this method starts off, we want to have this, so we want to have this user information, right? So the user is going to be retrieved from this user model, right? But now we're going to get that from our local storage, right? So the user will equal to the local storage dot get item, right? And it's user data, right? We're going to get the user data as a user. Does that work? This, how about that? So we'll get this from the local storage dot that as unknown. Let's see how that will turn out as, right? So here we'll say that this dot user dot user ID, right? So we'll get that, and then we'd want to have that vote. No, it's not a vote ID, it's actually a party ID, right? So that party ID will be this dot vote. Yeah, that's actually like the vote ID will be the party ID. And now we're going to be passing this into this guy and then getting it to a promise, right? Dot then, and then we'll get the data from there, and then this is of type any, right? Type any, then this, so we wanna console.log, wanna console that data, right? And then We'd also love to just catch that. Console.log this error. When a console log this error, then this is our tab any, right? So we'd have some sort of an error message. So error message. Right? Is it actually an error message? Nah, I can't say it, but we'll just call it error message in this instance. So what we'll have is this will say this dot user, right? This dot error message equals to the data we'll be getting back, and then this dot error message will say you have already voted. Yeah, so you can't vote because you already voted, right? So yeah, that's just it, I guess. So let's see, that's that. Okay, let's just try putting it somewhere here as an H1 tag, and then have that error message, right? And then have that class as just error text. This is just an error text. So let's see. So if this user tries to process this, it should initially just let them vote. Now let's see. Vote the DA. Let's hope that works. What happened? Okay, let's try to get that from our console log. Is this started? No, that wasn't started, sorry. My bad. Let's wait for it to start. All right, so now that's started. So how this will work is we'll go to our login with Sibonelo, and then 123, now, right, 43, we are logged in, vote the DA, let's see. What are we getting? What is this? What are we getting? So we're actually getting, what did we get? Whoa. I think I'm the one who made a mistake. Or did I? Let's check. So I'm processing this guy, right? And then coming into this home page, right? So let me first console.log our vote, right? Wanna console log our vote? Vote is that? All right, so I got that from my users.id. Now let's see what I'm getting in there, right? When I click the process button, right? Let me try to do a vote. Okay, login, Sibonelo, 143, and we are in. Okay, so process, what happened? So the user ID was invalid. So the user ID was not known, basically. So what I would want to first get to is, what are we getting in this console log? Console log of that get user, right? Because there are many ways to kill a cat. So let's just get that from our, what do you call this? User data. Let's see, what is our user data? Let's do this. So our user data is now this strange object. All right, so this is just this strange object. All right, so we are here in our login. So what we noticed is that, like, we want to pass in our user into this local storage, but we want to pass the user data as like a string. So we'll just JSON stringify this object we're getting from the data, right? And then after that, when we retrieve it from the home page, as in when it first like loads, right, we'd want to get this user, right, equals to that. And then we'll just remove this console log. That was just for testing purposes. So this user will now equate to that specific what we're passing, right? So, and then initially what will happen is when we pass in our ID, now we'll get it from that user, right, which we're getting from the local storage. So let's try running that and see what goes on, right? Sibonelo, 143, let's log in, let's vote the EFF and process. So what happens is that we are passing in the user ID. So what line is that? 40, 45. So yeah, so what we're getting to is the fact that we are passing in, okay, now where am I at? What am I trying to do? Let's see. Am I getting an error message? No. Okay, so what's happening here is that I'm getting this error that it cannot read a property of an undefined. Property of an undefined. Now that's crazy. Right, ladies and gents. I have then done the post request to process the vote, right? So that when the user clicks on process, then they could actually do the voting, right? So I've been doing this craziest thing, which kept me for hours trying to check where the error was, right? So actually what was actually happening is that on this user, right, I wasn't returning this actual HTTP request, or should I rather say the promise. So I just kept on saying that it couldn't read like a property of undefined. So you might as well just want to check that if you encounter that same problem like me, because I tried being on Stack Overflow for hours, but I couldn't get it. But anyways, let's go back to the logging in. So that, and then, no. Let me have that printed out here. Let's go to this guy, right? And then we'll have this dot error message, which is not necessarily an error message, right? And this will return what we're getting from data, right? And yeah, it is what it is. Like, moment of truth, let's see the first vote going to, oh, this guy, oh, come on. There's something I need to change first. I need to say this dot user dot user ID. I mean to say user ID, right? And then now this dot vote ID. I need to pass that vote ID. Now save and let's test, right? User is logging in. The password is 143. Successfully logged in. Let's try voting them for EFF and let's see. Let me remove this breakpoint. Just wanted to remove that breakpoint and just continue. You have already voted. So this user has already voted, so they can't vote again if they've already voted, right? So let's try Bob and try voting. Voting for Bob. Bob will go for IFP. You have successfully voted, right? And then we can register another user. Say it's Nick, and then the password is admin. All right. Then Nick is successfully registered. Just go there, Nick. And then the password is admin, right? Let's try to log in, right? Never. And then say Nick wants to vote for VF and process that. You have successfully voted.
I just solved it! Yes! Woo! Okay, now my life has no purpose.
So, pretty much, that is the system. I'll constantly try to update it there and there, but it does the most basic of functionalities, right? And the system on its own can't allow users to actually vote. So let's come here to these parties and see exactly if we are getting something. Oh yeah, so we see that there's 1, 2, 3 people who have already voted. Yeah, guys, please don't forget to like, share, and subscribe. And catch me on the next videos. I'll try to update the system and make it more and more better. But, like, I mean, I didn't have much time to, like, you know, plan it out and do it to the most efficient way possible. But, yeah, that's just it. Peace.